believe they arrive on the 28th of November, if I remember right. And they're going to hit the road running. But pray for them. They've got a lot going on with that. I believe they watch our services online from Costa Rica regularly. And so if you're watching tonight, we are praying for you guys. And we're going to pray for you all as a family tonight. So rejoicing over that. Okay, some other prayer requests there on the front of your bulletin. And some of these are serious in nature. So make sure you not only give your attention, but also your heart's prayer too. Margaret Best has been hospitalized due to COVID-19, but she is responding well to the treatment, and she seems to be on the mend. Obviously, anything could happen, but we're rejoicing with her that she's seeming to be recovering well. So pray for her. And then Pierre Zabizewski tested positive for COVID-19 as well. He is, as far as I know, he is at home, and he's experiencing mild to moderate symptoms, but it doesn't seem to be in any danger. Pray for him. And then I went by and saw Myrtle Valerie in the hospital today. What the conversation as it went, it just comes down to Myrtle is very discouraged because she's been sick for a very long time. And Myrtle needs our prayers and our support. And I would say that if you pray for Myrtle without telling her, that's great. But if you pray for Myrtle and tell her through card or through letter or phone call, that's better. So let's carry Myrtle to health. I stood outside of her room while a physical therapist, occupational therapist or someone was in her room working with her. And he said, "You are very strong. You are very strong." So she has the strength. She just needs the encouragement. So as a church family, let's do our part to help encourage her and carry her back to health. And then I spoke with Taylor Bryce and Tiandre's twin sister today, and he was recently hospitalized. Tiandre has lost his speech, and they believe it's due to some emotional trauma. They're not sure all the reasons. They've ran a battery of tests on him and can't seem to get any answers. He has an appointment to see a neurologist and some other specialists, but we need to pray for Tiandre that they can figure out what's wrong with him and he can get better. So he's home resting, but still no answers. So pray for Tiandre. And then I got a call from David Greer. This is sort of an interesting scenario, but David Greer's son has COVID, and he didn't get it from here or anything, but he has COVID. David Greer's been tested and came out negative. But David Greer's son was at home in bed resting, and his daughter, this would be David Greer's granddaughter, the David Greer's son's daughter, Harper, fell out of her bunk bed and landed on her head, and blood started pouring out of her ear. And so the son, with COVID and all, threw the daughter in his car and drove her to the hospital. Didn't tell anyone he had COVID, but I mean, what else is he supposed to do? He's got to get his daughter to the hospital there. And everyone that came in contact with him ended up being laid off of work until they were able to test negative. But the little girl broke a bone behind her ear, but did not damage her brain. So praise God for that. She's going to be recovering for quite some time, and there is some concern that if she doesn't heal well, there could be some hearing loss. So Harper is just a small child, and we want to pray for her full recovery and also for David's son that he recovers from COVID. And then Jacob Okai is requesting prayer for Kelly Hubbard for his salvation, and also he has stage 4 cancer. And then Rose Vicente's boss, Liz Williams, tested positive for COVID. And then Valerie Chipio is requesting prayer for her husband, Tim, who's dealing with business matters. And then Valerie's cousin, Julie, who is battling breast cancer after a 12-year remission. So we want to pray for Julie and then for Tim as he's handling business matters. And then you see the other prayer requests there below. And for sake of time, we won't read them out loud now, but from last week. I will give one update here. Pat Blake, she is home tonight after visiting the dentist and having a rough time with the dentist. So we need to pray for her that she feels better from that visit there. I believe she's watching at home tonight. So Pat, you don't need to say anything, but I hope you feel better. All right. Let's pray for these and then ask God to bless our service tonight. And then after that, we'll have our missionary update from Pastor Morales. Let's pray. Lord, thank you that you are a God who hears and answers prayers. Lord, many people on this list are battling COVID-19. Lord, we didn't take the time to look at the praise reports, but two folks in our church who had COVID-19 are doing much better, if not totally over it. And we rejoice with Isaac and Jeannie that Isaac is back to work, and Jeannie is very soon to be back out and about living her normal life. And we praise you for their recoveries. Lord, we pray for Margaret Best. We're thankful that she's responding well. We pray for Pierre, who's dealing with it. You'd help him to feel all the way better. Pierre's son, who's battling the virus, and then Liz Williams, Rose's boss, who's battling the virus. We pray all of them would also see a full recovery. We pray for Myrtle, Lord, as she's discouraged from about a year's length of time with hospital visits and, Lord, just feeling crummy. And, Lord, after a while it gets to you. I can only imagine. And so, Lord, we pray for Myrtle that she would feel encouraged and loved. And, Lord, may our church really put her on our shoulders and do our very best to help her feel cared for. And, Lord, we pray for T'Andre. And, Lord, we don't know everything that's going on there. Doctors seem to be confused and not able to find answers. Lord, we pray that T'Andre would feel better. Lord, that he would not suffer. Lord, that whatever his issue is, that would come about. We pray for Harper Greer, who fell off her bunk bed and landed on her head. And Lord, we pray that her healing would, or rather her hearing, would not be damaged at such a young age, but that she would make a full recovery. And then, Lord, we pray for Kelly Hubbard. We pray that Kelly would get saved and that you would use Brother Okai to continue to be a strong witness in his life. Give Brother Okai wisdom to know when to witness and how to witness. And Lord, we pray for his salvation. And then also, as he's battling this cancer, Lord, that he'd be saved before he passes. And Lord, if it's possible, if it would be your will that you would heal him, we pray that as well. And then, Lord, for Tim, as he's dealing with business matters, I know that this pandemic has shook up Tim's workflow and made him search for alternate ways to pay his bills. Give him wisdom as he makes decisions. We pray for Julie as she battles breast cancer after a 12-year remission. And then, Lord, for the Ordonez family as they're making plans to move here, Lord, that there would be no interruption of that, that they'd be able to get here in a way that is safe and swift and without any interruptions. And then, Lord, we pray for Rakita as she is requesting prayer for Chris Howard and his salvation. Lord, we pray for Isaiah as he's battling allergies. And Lord, just comfort for him as he has a couple of days of grieving coming up, and then for his mother's health. And then, Lord, Tom has requested prayer for our country. And Lord, we do pray that as the election results are being tabulated and finalized, that they would be done in a way that's honest and fair. Lord, that any fraud would be uncovered. And Lord, that the results of the election would be true. And then, Lord, we pray that after this has been independently verified and a final decision has come down, Lord, that there would not be fighting or strife in our streets. Lord, there would be reconciliation among Americans. And Lord, that we would come together as a country and be one, that we would put down our political swords and cease the proverbial stabbing of each other, and even some cases the burning of buildings and throwing of rocks into windows and the looting and the stealing. We pray that you would guard and protect our country from that. And Lord, that you would use this time of brokenness in our country to send revival. Lord, may the church be unified, not divided. Lord, may we be there to help America heal. And Lord, may we be people that put our eyes on the King of Kings and Lord of Lords and not on a seat behind a desk in the White House. Lord, help us to put you first and praise you. And Lord, may we show this country what it means to shine a bright light in a dark world. Lord, unify us and help us. Lord, many people here tonight and many people represented by our church are struggling and hurting. Lord, they're depressed, they're sad, they're disappointed, their heart hurts, They're discouraged. They're weak. Maybe it's health. Maybe it's emotions. Maybe it's even spiritual. Lord, whatever it would be, during this time, we pray that you would heal the wounded and the brokenhearted and bind up those that are broken. And Lord, help us to be agents of love, agents of encouragement, agents that defer, and agents that care. Lord, help us to channel up to you and show a hurting world all those things that are true and right. Lord, we pray that you'd be with the rest of our service, the discipleship, the teen class, the master clubs, the Bible study in here. Lord, may it all bring honor and glory to you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Pastor Morales will come with our missions update at this time. All right.
Okay, missions update for this week. We don't have a video, and we don't even have a picture. Okay, the missionary that we're highlighting this week is in a country that we call undisclosed. We're not disclosing the information because it's dangerous for him and for the ministry that he has, he and his family. And so they're in a field that for their safety's sake, we do not let anyone know. Now, again, if you want to know the exact information as far as names and country, obviously you can come to me after personally, but we don't want to post anything that would be online for their safety's sake. And so he's working with nationals to plant churches in the capital region of the country. And so some of the things that I'm going to say this evening as I read this report is going to sound kind of odd, but you'll understand why. In his most recent prayer letter, he said, and I quote, prior to the world being turned upside down, plans were solidly in place for the planting of three new churches in strategic cities along the Central Highway. Prospects were good for having national pastors grow the fledgling works under their leadership early on. However, interprovincial travel was suspended, and for a time, so were the church planting projects. And then he goes on to name the name of one of the national pastors. I'm just going to call him Brother National, okay? Amen? So you'll know what I'm referring to when I say that. So Brother National graduated from, and I won't name the Bible Institute just for safety's sake. He graduated from Bible Institute in July 2009. Even prior to graduation, his focus had been church planting. Brother National and his wife planted an independent Baptist church in a town that we won't name. And he became, this is kind of odd for me to do this way, but it works. Amen. He planted a church in a particular town. He became its first pastor. He is currently the director of domestic missions and responsible for the coordination of the church planting projects. He has had oversight of several successful church plants in recent years. At present, there are 12 nationals who are part of the church planting team. This particular individual is a soul winner and a faithful church planter for more than a decade. Our missionary writes, I have admired his zeal that has in turn inspired many other nationals. And then he goes on to say that sadly, Brother National's wife went home to be with the Lord on July 16th. So please pray for him. They were a great team. She loved the Lord and faithfully supported her husband's work for many years. She will truly be missed by all of us that knew her. So I want to keep you engaged with this particular letter. There's a lot of information in here that I think will be encouraging. As Pastor mentioned, there's a lot of discouragement going on, particularly due to the virus and then, of course, the election season. And you'll see that in comparison, we got it pretty good. Amen. Let's continue. Before COVID, they had a serious shortage of just about everything, including eggs, toilet paper, and gas, which makes travel more difficult and more costly, if not impossible at times. Shortages of essential goods, including food and long lines, were becoming the new normal. The poor material and economic state of the country has been exacerbated, obviously, by COVID. In his letter from April, our missionary wrote, he included some excerpts from some of his ministry partners. And I'm going to read some of those for you so you can understand. How many of us, you all remember back in February and March when we were having a hard time finding toilet paper? I have a hard time finding, you know, getting certain essentials. I remember those days. It's gotten better, obviously, and we still have a hard time finding disinfectant wipes even now. But nonetheless, it's bad for us, nowhere near as bad as it is for them. He went on to say, this is the description of their situation, and I quote, here we are all also calmly trusting in the mercies of the Lord and that he is in control in all this. It is a little difficult sometimes, but the Lord never fails. Sometimes even the most basic things are not easy to find, but this is where we are. We are still unable to meet for services, and very few can access social media. Some meet with small groups in their homes and remain somewhat connected in sharing prayer requests, devotions, etc. As a specific need arises, we visit by phone because the government suggests as much isolation as possible. On the other hand, as you already know, food and other things are now scarce. God never forsakes us. I love how he inserts that in there. He protects and provides for us. A few weeks ago, another denomination received a donation of boxes of fortified rice, and they shared with us, and we were able to distribute them to the brethren of the church and others in need in the community. Yesterday, I was able to find sacks of corn flour and a few boxes of cucumbers. Starting today, with great care and great discretion, we plan to distribute what we have, beginning with the oldest and the most needy. Pray for us. We trust that God will use all of this for his glory and for the salvation of many people so they can be prepared for his coming. All projects have practically stopped moving forward due to this situation and all its related factors. And so when I read these, I think, man, my small inconveniences of having to wear a mask in a church, or excuse me, in a store aren't so bad. Amen? Because I can go and find the things that I want for my home and for my family. He goes on to say, the impedance of the supply of petroleum has affected nearly every aspect of daily life here. Last weekend, there were long lines waiting for gas at every gas station we saw. There has been an ample supply of rental cars, but we did wait 2 hours to fill up. 2 hours to fill up gas. Wow. One driver told me he had waited from 9 p.m. until 8 a.m. the next day. We were thankful. Could you imagine waiting all night just to get gas? We were thankful that our wait was relatively short. Many goods have been rationed due to the increased difficulties of transportation. This has resulted in a scarcity of essentials such as bathroom tissue, cooking oil, eggs, milk, flour, etc. These uncertainties in turn have caused anxiety among the people. Hardly anyone is left unscathed from this situation. So that's one of his ministry partners there in the country where our missionary is working. He quotes another ministry partner, which says, and I quote, "We also pray for you and hope in the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ to see you when this plague passes." Interesting how he referred to it as a plague. "I am the only one that goes out, and that is because I must look for food. Food is very scarce, and the little bit that is on the shelves at the store are very rationed. For example, yesterday afternoon, I went out to look for bread, and on the way, I had to queue. I had to queue for more than an hour to buy toilet paper. They sell you a single package, and you must queue a second time, since the next day it is doubtful that the product exists. Thank the Lord, we have most of the very basic needs met. God is good, and we rest in his protection and provision. As for the virus, they are talking about contagions in the environment. We are forced to quarter at home as family, managing the stress of having two children confined to a small apartment. All the larger stores have closed. There are no places to buy meals, and the lines for the few smaller stores that are open are an entire block long. Our area is in quarantine, and you cannot leave the municipality. I have had to buy things at a premium price from those who resell at extorted prices. We trust God that he will not let us go hungry." Amen. American Christians, we see folks in other countries praying that they don't go hungry. "We are able to join a church group on WhatsApp," that's a social media app, "for services and hear the pastors preaching. Brother, this is not easy. I only tell you this so that you can see how the situation is here. We can only trust God and stay calm." I don't know about you, but every time I read something like this from our missionaries, it's encouraging in one aspect, it's discouraging in another aspect. To know that there are people living in these conditions during this virus situation. And in some cases, we know it's not only the virus. Here's another excerpt, I'll get the word out, and I'll be done. You'll want to hear the last sentence here in this excerpt. "Expressing political opinions is not wise in our country. I rarely ever mention our target country by name in our correspondences. No religious visas were granted for 2020 by the authorities, and some have speculated that it was retribution for evangelical churches expressing openly their opposition to redefining the traditional family. Some incorrectly assume that the government would change with a different political leader. This fails to consider an ideology that has had over 60 years to entrench itself, and it's in fact has embedded itself into other countries as well. One of my concerns is that the authorities will use the COVID-19 virus as a pretext to not allow churches to reopen for a prolonged period. Interprovincial travel is still prohibited, and our efforts are delayed, but our church planning goals remain the same. We try to put things in perspective, and I want you to hear this very clearly, and I think all of us need to remember this. We try to put things into perspective, remembering Francis Havergal's words, quote, "My disappointment is his appointment. My disappointment is his appointment." And I don't know about you, but there's many times in my Christian walk where I'm disappointed. And that spoke to my heart. That reminded me that he's in control, he's sovereign, and all things still do work together for good for those that love God and those who are called according to his purpose. So make sure we pray for this missionary and his work, and don't be discouraged, Christian. No matter what the results of this election are, like Pastor mentioned, God's still in control. He's still the King of Kings. He's still in charge, and we're still his children. Amen? Pastor.
Come on forward, Brother Jason, as we prepare to collect the offering here. Let's just remember that when we take our money and put it in the plate for missions, we are helping missionaries that are in these conditions. Not every missionary is in this condition, but some of our missionaries are. And your faithfulness to give to missions helps these people to be able to buy eggs and toilet paper and get through that. You know, as a man, I think through how rough that would be as a man, how much worse it would be for my wife. And these people have wives, and they need us to make sure we're consistent in our giving, but they also need us to make sure we're consistent in our praying. So let's make sure we lift them up. Thank you so much for sharing that, Pastor Morales. Let's pray for the offering this evening. Lord, would you bless the offering? Help us, Lord, to be faithful week in and week out in giving. And the Lord, help us to increase our giving, knowing that there are people around the world that have it much, much worse than we do. And Lord, our giving can help them get by. And then, Lord, help us to increase our praying. May we not forget our missionaries. Lord, may our folks get a list of the missionaries and pray for them and over them on a daily basis or at least a weekly basis. And Lord, protect them in this time. Protect this missionary in this time. And Lord, our prayer is that the doors would open so that he can begin to see churches planted all over the world again or all over that area again. Be with the rest of our service in Jesus' name. Amen. Discipleship, you can slip out at this time. If you're not, I would encourage you to scoot forward and so that we can enjoy the Bible study. Maintain social distancing, please, but if you can scoot forward, that would be a great help to me. That's a happy song. Thank you, Miss Bernice, for playing that. I really enjoyed that. Hebrews chapter 12 in your Bibles this evening. Hebrews chapter number 12. We're going to pick up where we left off last week. I'll give a little bit of an introduction to just sort of help those who didn't hear the Bible study last week to be able to overcome the learning curve. Just enough to help them with that, and then we'll pick up right where we left off last week after a short review here. Hebrews chapter number 12, and let's do this. Let's begin the reading in verse number 24. Verse number 24. And so if you would stand for the reading of God's Word this evening, if you're able to do that. Hebrews chapter 12, and verse 24, and we'll read down to the end of the chapter. It says, "And to Jesus, the mediator of the new covenant, and to the blood of sprinkling that speaketh better things than that of Abel. See that ye refuse not him that speaketh. For if they escaped not who refused him that spake on earth, much more shall not we escape if we turn away from him that speaketh from heaven, whose voice then shook the earth. But now he hath promised, saying, yet once more I shake not the earth only, but also heaven. And this word, yet once more, signifieth the removing of those things that are shaken, as of things that are made, that those things which cannot be shaken may remain. Wherefore, we receiving a kingdom which cannot be moved, let us have grace, whereby we may serve God acceptably with reverence and godly fear. Verse 29, for our God is a consuming fire. And the Bible study this evening is Jesus' kingdom is better than Moses' kingdom. And we began that last week. We'll conclude that thought this week. Let's pray. Lord, help the Bible study to make sense as we do our best to take your word and explain it. Lord, give me wisdom and conciseness of tongue. And Lord, for the listeners this evening, may they be engaged. No doubt many people here, their minds are frazzled and wearied. Many folks stayed up last night to watch election coverage and maybe got a little less sleep tonight, or a little less sleep last night, and their body is wearied. And Lord, we praise you that they're here. But Lord, whatever the reason would be, help us all to focus in. And Lord, we look forward to the day we get to sit in heaven and hear you exegete the scriptures and explain and teach, and it's going to be great. But Lord, now tonight, use my feeble tongue and help us to do our best to understand in Jesus' name. Amen. You can be seated. And so, again, quickly to recap, for those of you who were here last week, this will be repetitive. For those of you that weren't, or maybe you just forgot because you have a short memory, amen, this will be helpful to you. And so, the book of Hebrews was written to the Jewish Christians to help them understand and remind them that everything in the Old Testament was a shadow to Christ. And the Jews had gotten in the habit of worshiping the shadow, all right? Imagine that you have a bright light shining down on the cross, and that bright light that hits the cross creates the shadow behind the cross in the spectrum of time. And so the Old Testament is filled with types. I heard one person put it this way: the Old Testament is the slides, the New Testament is the slide projector. The Old Testament are the slides, the New Testament is the slide projector. You ever get the little toy when you were a kid? I don't think they have these anymore, but you stick the little circular disc down and you look through and you pull the lever on the side and you use the daylight, right? And have you ever had one of those discs without the contraption you put it in, and you hold it up to the sun and to the light and you try to see what that is? And the Old Testament, there are all sorts and types of Jesus Christ. But then you take the Old Testament and you lay it up against the New Testament, and you see all of those sacrifices in Leviticus and the law in Exodus and Deuteronomy and all that the prophets prophesied and all that was laid out by the kings and the messianic psalms and even going back into the Garden of Eden with all of the types there. All of that was nothing more than slides that go in the slide projector of the New Testament and show us Christ. And maybe there isn't a better book in the New Testament to do that than the book of Hebrews. Because the book of Hebrews quotes over and over and over again the Old Testament in the New Testament within the context of the life of Christ, of the life of Christ. So that is the backdrop of the book. Now, what is the backdrop of this chapter, all right? We've been told from chapter 1 up through chapter number, the end of chapter number 10, Jesus is better than this, and Jesus is better than that, and this part of Judaism, Jesus is better than that, and that part of Judaism. And listen, Jesus is the completion of the priesthood. His blood was the final sacrifice to be shed. He's greater than Moses. He's greater than Abel, and he's greater than Abraham, and he's greater than Enoch. And then you get to chapter 11, and what do we see? We see that all of the people in chapter number 11 were not great because of who they were. They were great because of who they believed in. Who did they believe in? They believed in the Messiah. They believed in Jesus. And so even the heroes of the Old Testament that you make such a big deal out of, the only reason why they're great is because they believed in a coming Messiah. Their attention was on the Messiah. If their attention was on the Messiah, then Jew, your attention also needs to be on the Messiah. And then we get to chapter number 12, and chapter 12 opens with an exhortation that we run our race, that we set aside the weights and the sins, and we run with patience. And then it transitions into how we run with patience. We run our race by living a disciplined life. And if we're going to be a disciplined runners, then we must face discipline by God in order to be disciplined runners in the spiritual race. And so then a whole section is laid out on God disciplining His children and the responses to that discipline. You have those that respond well, and then you have those like Esau who did not respond well, and that root of bitterness springs up and defiles them, and they become fornicators. And even though they repent, they can't find that repentance with tears because they've pushed things too far. Their rebellion has forfeited some things for them. And then off the heels of that, we come to the passage we're studying tonight, all right? So the passage that we're studying tonight, we began last week, we're continuing this week, is this idea that, hey, the kingdom of Moses is represented by a mountain. And that mountain is called Hebron or Mount Sinai, Mount Sinai. Exodus chapter 19, we find the Israelites making their way to Mount Sinai. By the way, Mount Sinai is the place where while Moses was working for his father-in-law, he was tending to his sheep, and he looked and he saw a bush that was burning but not consumed. That bush was on Mount Sinai. And he walked over to the bush and he was told to remove his shoes because he was on holy ground. That Mount Sinai is a very, very special location, and it's still there today. And the top of the mountain is still blackened today, and there's still a cave there where Elijah would later go and hide out. And there's still the altar there where they put the golden calf, and there's still a mass burial ground just a little ways away, and there's still a place where the offerings were had and the animals were offered up to the Lord in order for there to be penance made for their sin. That location is still there, but that location, what it represents is the kingdom that God used Moses to begin, the earthly kingdom that God used Moses to begin with the Israelites. It was at that mount, Mount Sinai, where the law was given. It was at that mount where the Israelites would get their civil law, their moral law, their dietary laws. All that would be laid out to Moses there on Mount Sinai. And so Mount Sinai represents the Old Testament and the Old Covenant. The Mount Sion represents the New Testament, the New Covenant, and that is located in heaven. So Sinai is located in earth, and that was the first thing we looked at. And Mount Sion, S-I-O-N, is represented or is found in heaven. Look down with me at verse number 22 of our text tonight. Hebrews chapter 12 and verse number 22. It says, "But ye are come unto Mount Sion, and unto the city of the living God, the heavenly Jerusalem, and to an innumerable company of angels, to the general assembly and church of the firstborn, which are written in heaven, and to God, the judge of all, and to the spirits of just men made perfect." And so where is this located? This Mount Sion is not found on earth. This Mount Sion is located in heaven. Last week we looked at Revelation chapter 14, verse 1, 2, and 3, and we saw that Mount Sion is located in heaven. And so Jesus' kingdom is represented by Mount Sion. Moses' kingdom is represented by Mount Sinai. And then we looked at a comparison between Moses and Jesus. And then we moved on and we looked at a comparison of the blood of animals that was shed there by Mount Sinai versus the blood of Jesus, which is sprinkled on the mercy seat in heaven by Mount Sion. And we took the time to look at that without rehashing, explaining and reviewing. The last thing we covered last week was law versus grace. And I want to take just a moment here and set the table for the rest of the Bible study here. Mount Sinai represented the law. You remember the story? Moses goes up into the mount there and he meets with God, and God gives him the Ten Commandments. In fact, God would etch them on stone. The first Ten Commandments, he would etch them in stone himself, and he would give them to Moses, and then God would tell Moses, get back down to the camp because the people are behaving in a way that's wicked. And so he'd come down halfway down the mount, and who did he meet other than Joshua? And Joshua says, there is the sound of war in the camp. Now, they're so high up, they don't know what's going on down there. And Moses looks back at Joshua and says, that's not the sound of war. That is the sound of music. Those people are worshiping a false god and making our God very angry. They get down to the base of the mountain, and Moses looks out, and what does he see? He sees the people, they're dancing in a lewd manner to music that would sound like a modern-day heavy metal rock and roll around a golden calf. They had picked up this idolatrous golden calf from their time in Egypt. And Moses loses his temper, and he breaks the Ten Commandments. And then he takes the golden calf, and he grounds it into dust, and he puts it in the river, and he makes them drink their golden calf. And then what does he do? He then takes the tabernacle and he casts it outside of the people. And there he gets on his face before God and he begs God to forgive them. He even says to God, blot out my name. I will go to hell for them, but do not let your presence depart from these people. And God is so moved by Moses' prayer. The Bible says that God repented of the evil he thought to do unto Israel. He changed his mind. Moses' prayer changed the mind of God. And then Moses would go back up into the mount. But this time he'd have to etch out the commandments with his own two hands. God wasn't going to do it for him this time. God said, in your anger, you broke those. You shouldn't have done that. Now you get to take the time to carve them in stone. And so he did that. Mount Sinai represents the law. Here's the truth. The first time Moses was given the law, while he was getting the law, the people were at the base of the mountain breaking the law. They were breaking the law in a way that was ugly. They were breaking the law in a way that was very obvious and very shaking their fist in the face of God. But can I tell you something? The second time when Moses came down off the mountain, they weren't doing that. But can I tell you, those people broke the law every single day afterwards. The law is not flawed. We are flawed. You with me? And the law is not there for me to look at you and say, you do a better job of keeping the law than me. So that must mean that you're going to get into heaven and I'm not. No, the law is there to say, we all fall short. You know what the Mount Sion represents? It represents grace. Now, it doesn't do away with the law. It completes the law. Jesus said in Matthew 5:17, he said, think not that I have come to destroy the law, but to fulfill it. Jesus came to fulfill the law, and he does that with grace. He does that with grace. I gave you this quote last week. Grace requests a much higher standard than the law requires. What do I mean by that? Because we're not being threatened at every turn, God expects a higher standard. With the law, watch this now, with the law, the standard wasn't as high, but the threat was more imminent. A woman is caught in adultery. We looked at this on Sunday morning in John chapter 8. A woman is caught in adultery. She's to be stoned on the outskirts of town. In the New Testament, under grace, a woman caught in adultery, is she to be stoned? No. No. What do we call that? We call that grace. We call that a wiggle room. Now, that doesn't mean God condones it. But that does mean God gives us room to grow. Aren't you glad that we're not held to the standard, or rather to the consequences of the Old Testament law? Aren't you glad? Because I'll tell you right now, I would have been dead like 30 times over again, right? If I would have been held to that. Instead, grace comes along and does not threaten to kill us. No, grace gives us room, but the standard of righteousness, the standard, the expectation gets raised. It gets raised. So in the Old Testament, we paid a tithe. In the New Testament, God says, give according to how much God's grace has touched your heart. And as we grow in grace, we grow in our giving. In the Old Testament, they were commanded to bring a sacrifice. And that sacrifice was in the form of an animal. In the New Testament, we don't bring an animal sacrifice. No, our flesh is the sacrifice. You see how grace requests a higher standard than the law requires? In the Old Testament, they went to the tabernacle or temple to visit with God. That was the law. In the New Testament, we are the temple. We are the temple. You see here again, grace has raised the standard where the law, from where the law was, and God expects a little bit more. We looked at Romans chapter 6 where Paul said to the church of Rome, he said, are we going to take advantage of grace? Are we going to sin in the face of grace? Oh, we should not do that. We should not do that. And so law versus grace. With that as the background, let's jump into the last two thoughts this evening on the back of your bulletin there. And let's finish looking at Hebrews here, and Hebrews chapter 12. And let's let the Bible do the teaching for us tonight. Notice next, earth shaken versus heaven and earth shaken. Earth shaken versus heaven and earth shaken. And again, this is a comparison of Moses' kingdom represented by Mount Sinai to Jesus' kingdom represented by heaven and earth. And so look with me at verse number 18. Hebrews chapter 12, verse number 18. It says, "For ye are not come unto the mount that might be touched, and that burned with fire, nor unto blackness and darkness and tempest." Last week when we read Exodus 19, chapter 19, verse 10 through 25, we saw that the Lord came down in a dark cloud, and there was a shaking of the earth, an earthquake experience when God spoke. I'm sure that was powerful. I'm sure that was tremendous. I'm sure that was awesome. But what do we know? We know that it scared the people out of their mind. Look down at verse number 21. Verse number 21 said, "And so terrible," speaking of the Sinai experience, "was the sight that Moses said, I exceedingly fear and quake." Even Moses the leader was left in some sort of trauma from God coming down and in that ferocious, omnipotent way, revealing His power to the Israelites. The earth was shaken when the law was given. How about Mount Sion? How about Mount Sion? Look at verse number 26. Again, notice that 18 down through verse number 21 speak of Mount Sinai. 22 through 28 speak of Mount Sion. All right, look at verse number 26. Notice there it says, "Whose voice then shook the earth," speaking of God at Sinai, "but now He hath promised, saying, yet once more I shake not the earth only, but also heaven. And this word, yet once more, signifieth the removing of those things that are shaken as of things that are made, that those things which cannot be shaken may remain." What is this talking about? God is not only going to shake the earth, and by the way, when the earth was shaken, it was just one location around Sinai. God is not just going to shake one mountain or a region around one mountain. God is going to shake the entire heaven and the entire earth with His voice. What is that talking about? I'll tell you what I believe it's talking about. Turn over to 2 Peter chapter number 3. 2 Peter chapter 3. That'd be to the right there. Hebrews, James, 1 Peter, 2 Peter. 2 Peter chapter 3. And look at verse number 10. One day, God is going to destroy this heaven and this earth. Now, there are theologians who believe that 2 Peter 3, 10 through 14 are not to be taken literal. But I'll just tell you this, as a student of the Bible myself, I default at taking the Bible literal unless it is very obvious or made clear by God Himself that we're not to take it literal. And so, like, when I read through Revelation, I'm not trying to read between the lines or try to read into and say, well, is John describing some sort of technology here? There may be some room for that in Revelation. My default is, if he's talking about demon locusts coming out of the pit of hell, he's not talking about Apache helicopters. He's talking about demon locusts coming out of the pit of hell. All right, my default is to just trust the Bible for what it says. And listen, if we get to heaven and find out that, you know, that was wrong, okay. The Lord will be, let God be true and every man a liar, right? We'll find that out at that time. I don't believe 2 Peter 3 is speaking metaphorically or in some sort of vague terms that are not to be taken literally. Here's what I believe is going to happen. Let's look at the passage. 2 Peter 3, 10 through 14. Keep in mind what we read about God's voice shaking the heaven and the earth. The Bible says, "But the day of the Lord will come as a thief in the night, in the which the heavens shall pass away with a great noise, and the elements shall melt with fervent heat. The earth also and the works that are therein shall be burned up. Seeing then that all these things shall be dissolved, what manner of persons ought ye to be in all holy conversation and godliness?" There's the spiritual application. "Looking for and hasting unto the coming of the day of God, wherein the heavens being on fire shall be dissolved, and the elements shall melt with fervent heat. Nevertheless, we, according to His promise, look for new heavens and a new earth, wherein dwelleth righteousness. Wherefore, beloved, seeing that ye look for such things, be diligent, that ye may be found of Him in peace, without spot and blameless." One day, the Lord is going to stand on Mount Sion, and He is going to open His mouth, and He is going to utter such a sound that the heaven and earth will shake and will be dissolved with a fervent heat. You see, on Mount Sinai, a region around a mountain or earth was shaken. From Mount Sion, the Lord will open His mouth, and all of this heaven and earth will be destroyed. And then a new heaven and earth will be presented to us that will live on forever. And by the way, this isn't in my notes, nor is it in Hebrews, but I think it's something that we should point out here. We don't have a lot of description of the new heaven and the new earth. We're given the description of the new Jerusalem, and that's it. That's one city, and that's all the description we get of all of the new heaven and the new earth. Folks, it's going to be an amazing experience. It's going to be an amazing experience. Think of it this way, all right? Right now we have earth and we have heaven where the Lord resides and the angels reside, right? And where the saints are, where Mount Sion is. And on earth we have the city of Jerusalem. The city of Jerusalem makes up one small portion of earth and heaven. And so if that scenario was still to be true in the new heaven and the new earth, that one Jerusalem is going to make up just a small portion of the rest, and we have no description in Scripture of the rest of it. Boy, God's going to destroy this heaven and this earth, and He's going to usher in a new heaven and a new earth. Well, Pastor, what will survive when God opens His mouth? What will survive? Turn over to John chapter 10. And verse number 28. John chapter 10 and verse number 28. Once God stands on Mount Sion and opens His mouth, and the heaven and the earth are shaken and caught on fire and destroyed, just a couple of things will survive. Look at John chapter 10 and verse number 28. These aren't on your notes or on the screen. These are just a couple things I scribbled down in my notes here. But I have this written down. The children of God will survive. Amen? The children of God will survive. Look at John chapter 10, verse number 28. And I have given to them eternal life, and they shall never perish. Neither shall any man pluck them out of my hand. Where will we be when the heaven and earth is being destroyed? In the hand of God. We're not going to be destroyed. Amen? Aren't you thankful for that? Now, if you're watching online, I believe everyone in the room is saved, or at least has professed to me that they're saved. But if you're watching online tonight and you're not saved, can I just say to you that the end of this world is coming one day? That's not a fairy tale. That's not fiction. That is fact. All right? By faith, I believe that the Bible is true. It's proven itself to be true over and over and over again. And one day there's going to be a rapture. And at the end of that rapture, there's going to be a millennial or a thousand-year reign of Christ. And then at the end of that reign, there's going to be a judgment of those who rejected God in their lifetime and never put their faith and trust in Jesus to save them. And then this heaven and earth are going to be destroyed, and a new heaven and earth are going to be brought in. And only those who in their lifetime, between their birth date and their death date, that put their faith and trust in Jesus will get to make it to the new heaven and new earth. And so if you haven't done that, remember what the Bible tells us. Behold, now is the accepted time. Behold, now is the day of salvation. Don't wait. Don't wait. James chapter 4 tells us, what is your life? It is even but a vapor that appeareth for a little time and then vanisheth away. I stand at a stove and I watch steam come up off of a pot, and as fast as it appears, it disappears. And in the grand scheme of eternity, not 100 years, not 1,000 years, not 10,000 years, not 100,000 years, not 1,000,000 years, not 100,000,000 years, not 100 billion years, but for all of eternity, those who have professed Christ during that little vapor of their life, or those who believed in Jesus as their ticket to heaven, those who were converted into or became the sons of God through that act of belief, only those get to make it into God's heaven. Boy, don't shun what God's created. One day His voice from Sion will rattle and shake and burn this heaven and earth. And only the children of God, as far as beings and the angels in heaven who survived the rebellion, only those will make it into heaven. Now, I was very careful to word it, the children of God. And here's why. My understanding of doctrine and study is, how do you define a child of God? All right, this is a neat little tidbit, a neat little nugget, okay? And there are people that disagree with me on this. There are Baptists that disagree with me on this, and that's okay. But this has been my observation and study of it. Only someone or something that was directly made by God is a child of God, okay? I'll give you an example, all right? Adam and Eve were made by the hands of God. Adam is called the Son of God. All right? How about the angels? The angels were made by the hands of God, and so they are called the sons of God. You may remember when Job, in the book of Job, where the Bible talks about the sons of God being called for a meeting, and Lucifer showed up. Why? Because he was directly made by God. How about John chapter 1 verse 12, where it says that we become a son of God when we believe on His name. Why? Because God reaches down and He makes us a new creature. You see that? So to be a son of God, God has been directly involved in shaping you and making you. The children of God survive. Now, not Satan and the third that were thrown out of heaven. They won't, because they are punished in the rebellion. But the rest of the children of God that are angels survive. And the redeemed in Christ survive. Notice the other thing that survives the destruction of the heaven and the earth is the Word of God. The Word of God. Turn over to Matthew chapter 24 and verse number 35. Matthew chapter 24 and verse number 35. Everybody still with me tonight? All right, good. Matthew 24, look at verse number 35. The Bible says, "Heaven and earth shall pass away, but my words shall not pass away." Heaven and earth shall shall pass away. And by the way, those who try to excuse away 2 Peter 3, 10 through 14 and say, oh, it's not an actual fire, it's metaphorically purifying the earth. Well, you've got to figure out then Matthew 24, 35 that says, heaven and earth will pass away, but my word shall not pass away. God's word will stand forever. You know, I like to make a point of application in the rightly dividing the word of truth. You know, tomorrow morning when you get up and read your Bible and pray, you spend time in this book right here. You know, you're spending time in something that is eternal. Facebook is not eternal. Twitter is not eternal. The United States of America and its election is not eternal. This is eternal. And I know I've been guilty of this in my life, but we get so distracted and caught up on things that are not eternal, and then that which is eternal sits on her nightstand or on her dresser or on the coffee table or kitchen table or gets left on the back seat of our car, and we never spend time in this, and we're wasting time on something that isn't eternal, and we're letting that pass which is eternal. Heaven and earth shall pass away, but my word shall not pass away. One day, God will stand on Mount Zion, and with his voice, he will cause the heaven and earth to burn with a fervent heat. Why? Because Jesus' kingdom is greater than Moses' kingdom, all right? One more thought here tonight, and that is, earthly kingdom. Sinai represents an earthly kingdom, and Zion represents a heavenly kingdom. And this brings us full circle back to the title, where we talk about Jesus' kingdom versus Moses' kingdom. All right, look at verse number 28 and 29 of Hebrews chapter 12. Let's finish out chapter 12 here. It says there, wherefore, we receiving a kingdom which cannot be moved, let us have grace, whereby we may serve God acceptably with reverence and godly fear. For our God is a consuming fire. All right, we're going to turn over to Revelation chapter 21 in just a moment. By the way, those of you watching at home, this is a last-minute edition, so these verses we'll read in Revelation 21 will not be on the screen. If you have a Bible nearby and you're watching at home, you have a couple of minutes to get that and be ready in Revelation 21, and you'll need to read from an actual Bible there. But while you're getting turned there and getting settled in Revelation 21, let me make a couple of introductory thoughts here. Earthly kingdom versus heavenly kingdom. There is a temptation in Christianity today to try to turn God into a coddling, overcaring, benevolent mother who looks the other way at wrongdoing. And the wrath of God that we find in the Old Testament, people in the New Testament want to dismiss it away. They don't want to talk about the punishing hand of God. It's almost as though God, it just pats someone on the head and says, well, you just be a good little boy and love me, and you show up to church on Sunday, and that's good enough. This is where we get a casual Christianity that is permeating America. Casual Christianity that permeates America. I preached Sunday night a very scathing sermon in some aspects about the holiness that God has called Christians to. And we talk about grace and how that the consequences are not immediate. But please understand that God does chasten us. And his chastening is different in the New Testament than the Old Testament, but his chastening is real. Look back at verse number 29. And this is a phrase pulled out of the Old Testament law, out of the Torah. For our God is a consuming fire. What is the author of Hebrews trying to say here? Hey, the nature of God does not change from the Old Testament to the New Testament. He was a consuming fire in the Old Testament. He is a consuming fire in the New Testament. Now, the methodology has changed, but who he is has not changed. And I just want to say this evening, don't cross God. Don't cross it. Don't cross it. I had a teacher in school named Mrs. Drake. She only taught 1 year. I felt bad for Mrs. Drake. She was my, let's see, 9th or 10th grade. I can't remember the year, but 9th or 10th grade science and math teacher. She went to school to be a teacher, but she did not. She was just not cut from the right cloth. And those poor kids in that school just ate her emotionally for lunch. And after 1 year of teaching and just it not going well, she hung it up and switched careers. I felt awful for her. But I'll tell you what I watched with Mrs. Drake, or Miss Drake, rather. I don't believe she was married. What I watched with Miss Drake was that the kids would push her buttons and push her buttons and push her buttons and push her buttons, and then she would snap. And when she snapped, boy, you wanted to crawl under the anything you could find because it would get ugly. And you know, God is measured, and God is careful, and God knows, but please understand that God's default is to be merciful and gracious and kind. And we trample on His grace, and trample on His grace, and trample on His grace, and God sends warning after warning after warning. At some point, He is a consuming fire, and He comes down hard on us, and we feel a severe punishment. I know that there have been times in my life where I've been in a pattern of living in sin, and I thought, I'm getting away with it. I'm getting away with it. No one has ever seemed to find out, or there are even people that maybe knew and nothing seemed to happen. Can I tell you something? That God may not punish on the spot, but God eventually gets around to punishing. He is a consuming fire. And that fire one day will burn this sinful, wicked planet up with a fervent heat. And God is going to create a new heaven and a new earth. And here we get the heavenly kingdom that God's grace brings. Turn over to Revelation chapter 21 if you're not already there. Give me a moment. I'm going to get over there. We're almost done this evening. I want you to see what the end game of the heavenly kingdom is. Now, God's fire, that consuming fire, one more observation before we read. That consuming fire does two things. It punishes and it purifies. It punishes and it purifies. What do I mean? I mean sometimes God turns up the heat underneath us and it hurts. One day, though, God is going to turn up the heat under our works in heaven. He's going to cut out the wood, hay, and stubble, and all that will be left are gold, silver, and precious stones that are made pure. And we're going to walk into the kingdom of heaven. We're going to walk into the kingdom of grace. And we're not going to experience the brokenness of Sinai. We're going to experience the healing and eternality of Sion. Look at Revelation 21. And I saw a new heaven and a new earth, for the first heaven and the first earth were passed away. By the way, I don't know how much more clear the Bible can be that the old heaven and earth are going away. And there was no more sea. And I, John, saw the holy city, New Jerusalem, coming down from a God out of heaven, prepared as a bride adorned for her husband. And I heard a great voice out of heaven saying, behold, the tabernacle of God is with men, and He will dwell with them, and they shall be His people, and God Himself, and be with them, and be their God. I love verse 4, and God shall wipe away all tears from their eyes. And there shall be no more death, neither sorrow, nor crying, neither shall there be any more pain, for the former things, Mount Sinai, the former things are passed away. And He that sat upon the throne, Mount Sion, said, behold, I make all things new. And He said unto me, write, for these words are true and faithful. And He said unto me, it is done. I am Alpha and Omega, the beginning and the end. I will give unto him that is athirst of the fountain of the water of life freely. He that overcometh shall inherit all things, and I will be his God, and he shall be my son. But the fearful and unbelieving and abominable and murderers and whoremongers and sorcerers and idolaters and all liars shall have their part in the lake which burneth with fire and brimstone, which is the second death. That's a reflection back to Revelation 20, 14 and 15. And there came unto me one of the seven angels, which had the seven vials full of the seven last plagues. There, I will show thee the bride, the Lamb's wife. And he carried me away in the spirit to a great and high mountain and showed me that great city, the holy Jerusalem, descending out of heaven from God, having the glory of God, and her light was like unto a stone most precious. That her light, by the way, speaking of the church, or rather the bride, even like a jasper stone, clear as crystal, and had a wall great and high, and had 12 gates, and at the gate 12 angels, and names written thereon, which are the names of the 12 tribes of the children of Israel, on the east 3 gates, on the north 3 gates, on the south 3 gates. Are you picturing this? On the west 3 gates. And the wall of the city had 12 foundations, and in them the names of the 12 apostles of the Lamb. So the 12 walls represent the Old Testament, and the 12 foundations represent the New Testament. It's all being brought together. That law and that grace are being found completed together there in this new Jerusalem. Verse number 14, in the wall of the city had 12 foundations, and in them the name of the 12 apostles of the Lamb. And he that talked with me had a golden reed to measure the city, and the gates thereof, and the wall thereof. And the city lieth four square, and the length is as large as the breadth. And he measured the city with the reed 12,000 furlongs. The length and the breadth and the height of it are equal. So this new Jerusalem is cubed. And he measured the wall thereof in 144 cubits, according to the measure of a man. All of this carrying significance. This is of the angel. And the building of the wall of it was as of jasper. And the city was pure gold, like unto clear glass. And the foundation of the wall of the city was garnished with all manner of precious stones. The first foundation was jasper. The second, sapphire. The third, and on down. Skip down to verse number 21. And the 12 gates were 12 pearls. Every several gate was of one pearl. And the street of the city was pure gold, as it were transparent glass. And I saw no temple therein. For the Lord God Almighty and the Lamb are the temple of it. And the city had no need of the sun, neither of the moon to shine in it. For the glory of God did lighten it, and the Lamb is the light thereof. And the nations of them which are saved shall walk in the light of it. And the kings of the earth do bring their glory and honor into it. And the gates of it shall not be shut at all by day, for there shall be no night there. And they shall bring the glory and honor of the nations into it. And there shall in no wise enter in anything that defileth, neither whatsoever worketh abomination or maketh a lie, but they which are written in the Lamb's book of life. Boy, if you're ever having a bad day, just go read Revelation chapter 21 and realize that is your future. As rough as it is today, as rough as it may be in your life, there may be a dark cloud of disappointment and failure and frustration and fear and fragility that's hanging over your head. And you may be walking around with your shoulders stooped and feeling like things aren't going well. Please understand that this is waiting in your future if your name is in that book. Isn't that great? Isn't that great? Mount Sinai brought us the law, and that law did nothing but point at us and show us how short we come. Mount Sion brings us grace and brings us this new heaven and earth and this heavenly kingdom. Christian, don't be disheartened. Don't be disheartened by what's going on in the world. Don't be disheartened what's going on in your world. Put your eyes on Jesus and know that one day all of this will just be a distant memory. Amen? Amen. Let's stand together. We'll be dismissed with a word of prayer. I hope Hebrews 12 was an encouragement to you, as we have paralleled Mount Sinai, Moses' kingdom, with Mount Sion, our Lord and Savior Jesus' kingdom. And next week we'll begin, in 2 weeks, we'll begin chapter number 13, the final chapter in Hebrews, and looking forward to that with you. Let's be dismissed with a word of prayer this evening and ask God's hand of blessing on us, and pray He brings us back safely next Sunday. Brother Reggie Nito, if you would, close us in prayer.